during pre-independence time, gold was converted from mercury, and they made gold, and some quantity also was mentioned, and it was presented to Mahatma Gandhiji for utilization in the freedom fight. It's written in the Birla temple on the right side on one of the plaques. So that's where it is recorded. Why people were interested in gold, our ancient time? They were definitely not interested in making gold, convert mercury into gold and so on, because gold at that time, native gold was available, not so scarce as it is now. So I don't think that was the interest. The interest in that was to produce what is known as atomic gold or white gold, which is a white powder of gold, which when you apply on your body, you become invisible. So today, I'm going to talk on these aspects, particularly in terms of materials, gold, copper, bronze, and silica, and Bharadwaj prism, Lohasav, and iron. These are the metals and so-called materials that I'm going to talk of. As has already been said, there was a lot of interest in making gold in ancient times, and it started, I don't know from what time, but at least the recorded historical evidences are Nagarjunacharya at the present day Nagarjun Sagar in Andhra Pradesh, that region, and partly into Karnataka, and then Yogi Vemana, who desperately tried to make gold out of mercury, and having failed, he became a yogi and he left all his kingdom also. Actually, he was a king. And then BHU, I tried to get a photograph of it, but I could not, my student could not find, is the next one that I came across where there is a written claim that during pre-independence time, gold was converted from mercury, and they made gold, and some quantity also was mentioned, and it was presented to Mahatma Gandhiji for utilization in the freedom fight. It's written in the Birla temple on the right side on one of the plaques. So that's where it is recorded. Then I come to one Sri Karra Veerabhadram and Santosh Karra, his son. Sri Karra Veerabhadram is, their family is very rich in Mantra Shastra and Jyotish and Ayurveda. So I have myself seen many manuscripts with him, Talapatra Grandhas, where the secrets of those mantras, in order to preserve, they have written in right hand to left hand side. So that a casual reader in whose hands it has gone cannot interpret what is written. So that is the kind of secrecy that pervaded. So people did not know how to make, or even if people knew, they could not succeed in making this. So this, when I visited, I had some other connection, but I won't discuss all that. I was shown a small piece of gold made by Sri Veerabhadramji and also subsequently by his son Santosh. I wanted to get a photograph of it. He said, you take the piece and go to the conference, no problem. He was busy in some ritual at that time, so he could not give me. That's what I mentioned. But you have to accept my word, and if any clarification is required, you are free to write to them on that email. He is available. That is the other person living who demonstrated and who showed me the piece of gold. Now, slightly different from what Dr. Mahesh said, maybe that one was not tested, the statue. The gold that these people claim is gold, but it is not gold. And in Ayurvedic terms, they say that it doesn't have prana, life it doesn't have. What that means metallurgically is you cannot melt it and then get back the gold piece. So whatever ornament or statue that you want to make, you have to make it in that form, and that's it. It will stand the test of purity by making a scratch on that stone, and all that is all right. But only thing is, it is not thermodynamically stable. So you cannot melt it and then make a gold chain or necklace and things like that from that. So, my intention here is not to encourage you to take up these things, but there are successes, there are failures in that. But one reference, maybe I will tell that why people were interested in gold, I will tell at the end in a different context. So Mercury, as Dr. Mahesh has already said, was a very important metal from which various other compounds were made and used in medicine. I have myself made this solidified mercury, so-called rustling, in BHU with the help of Dr. Jha, C.B. Jha. His name I have not written, forgotten. He was from Ayurvedic medicine, and since I was interested in this kind of things, so I once approached, and both of us, he said, sit down, let us make, I will show you how to make. And simply he had taken an iron pot in which copper sulfate was taken, and in fact mercury droplet was put in the iron, and then over that he has poured copper sulfate, and next day or after second day you get a small piece of solidified mercury. This is how solid rustling is, what people used to worship and all that. So I said, let me cut this and do the metallographic investigation from my background. So I have made a cut. My father incidentally was there at that time. He said, why did you do this kind of a thing? You are not supposed to, and all that. But anyway, that is the time when I was working on ITC superconductivity also. And I found that this rustling, or whatever that piece which I made into two halves, I did X-ray diffraction and all that. And I found that it has compounds of copper and mercury. And those compounds, it is a two-phase alloy. That means at different stages, it formed different compounds. And these compounds were close to the superconducting copper-mercury compounds, which they found out later on. Around that time. First was a ITC superconductor, which was an oxide superconductor, if some of the students, I don't know whether they know it or not. But this was also one of the, maybe that was the reason why people were interested in making rustling. These connotations and context we don't know. Unfortunately, we have missed that link. That is the reason. So, these are what are of importance. Then comes copper, and there is an institute in in Andhra Pradesh near Kandukuru in AP, which is it's an institute, Rasakalpa, Ancient Indian Technology Development. He had contacted me knowing my background and my interests, and then once they had sent me this saying that we are producing nano copper from a non-traditional way. Nano copper nowadays we produce by any nanotechnology, but they said that they produce. And he sent me these things. So I advised him, these are not nano in size because I am able to see the pictures in this way. But he then claimed that no, we can produce that also, but later on it becomes like this. But whatever it is, they are starting from, this is a known process for metallurgists and chemists, cementation process. By that process, they must be doing. But he didn't want to divulge the secrets of it. I said, I mean, I didn't further pursue. But anybody who is interested can always get copper from this. Apparently, he supplied this to DMRL when they wanted some copper. And scientists from DMRL also visited this particular case. I'm just only bringing out how different people are available in the country and who are capable of doing these things. So, next one is bronze. Once again, you had seen the demonstration of that famous Kannadi or handheld mirror. My interest in this, there are various studies which you can see it on internet also and so on. People claim, finally, even this is doubted, that the compound which is intermetallic is Cu65SN35, and some claim that it's not only simple binary intermetallic, but there are several elements within that and all that. I'm not going into that controversy. My interest in showing this is that those people who are, I don't know whether they're still here or not, they should be in a position to produce this mirror in a parabolic way so that this mirror has many advantages. I don't know whether any of you noticed or not. It is a front surface mirror. It's not a back surface mirror like a glass mirror. So it is the front surface it is reflecting and it is a highly corrosion resistant and so on. So, if you make optical telescopes with this parabolic mirror, it will be of great help. That is my idea. So, I just wanted to throw that suggestion to him, whether can you make that big? What I already know is in British Museum, there is something which is of this height, a mirror. That is the largest apparently that they have produced. But it's a flat mirror. What I want for that is an elliptical parabolic mirror. If that is not possible, make small flat mirrors and put them, paste them on a parabolic dish. That is also possible. So this is another suggestion. I don't know whether anybody is there to take these suggestions, but that is the shape which I was meaning. So I then go back to silica. It is produced from a liquid state, okay? Liquid means not melt the sand and then try to grow crystals of silica, but it is from herbal root. So only people like Dr. Mahesh or anybody who has contacts with some of those unknown persons in Kerala region in the forest. That is from where Professor Ram Chandra Rao got it. He showed me also when he was. I don't have a picture of it, unfortunately. So that's the interest in that. Now, we come to, in this last 1 minute, I will tell you about my collaboration with the Rasa Shastra department of BHU, where Ayurvedic department college has many of these. There is one student who did jointly with me, MD, and the prescribed procedure of making Lohasav, which is a tonic, iron tonic, generally given to pregnant ladies and other any other anemic people. And also it has many other applications, not only for that indication, many other indications. So they start with iron or steel turnings, and then they go through these processes of bhavana, vishesha sodhana, and marana. So what I did was not only to take optical and SEM pictures, but we analyzed the content of that end products of all these things by X-ray diffraction. And then I found that what they were getting is megamite in that in very fine powder. So this was part of Dr. Vijay Gupta's this one. He is right now with Ayush in this place. That is the reference. You can make a contact with him. And so I suggested to him, why, if you want to finally convert all that process into fine powder of oxide and then complex it with any liquid, generally it is amlaka ras, trifala ras. So I said, why not start with iron powder, iron oxide powder itself? So later studies he had done using hematite as well as magnetite ores, and from there we have conducted another one. So this part I will skip. Yesterday's in panel discussion I had mentioned this, that Agarias, if they can rehabilitate into their own position, profession, yeah, but Dr. Balal was not, yeah, they won't. Yeah, I know some part of the story which he also did not want to reveal, because late Professor Bhanu Prakash had spent some time in Bastar and made the iron in his presence, and he has videotaped all those things. And these, if I remember correctly, as he submitted to Indian Institute of Metals, those things are available. But the problem is, if they lose their traditional way of making, then there will not be anybody with you who can demonstrate that. So it is better if that fines can be made. And this is the suggestion which I threw yesterday, that that type of furnace which can be shifted from location to location and use the pellets and make the iron. I said in the beginning, why people were interested in gold, our ancient time? They were definitely not interested in making gold, convert mercury into gold and so on, because gold at that time, native gold was available, not so scarce as it is now. So I don't think that was the interest. The interest in that was to produce what is known as atomic gold or white gold, which is a white powder of gold, which when you apply on your body, you become invisible. That is the reason. So my formula, this is from Bharadwaj Vaimana Shastra. We have spent considerable time on this, met various Sanskrit scholars and tried to get the translation of it. What they say in that book is, according to Akash Tantra, the way it is put in inverted commas means Akash Tantra must have been another book which is not mentioned here. By mixing black mica solution with neem and bhunaga decoctions and smearing the solution on the outer body of Vimana made of mica plates. So what it means is, you apply this lotion and mica can become, can take different colors. It can take this color of the sky. So the object will disappear in that sense. If something, if this gets the background color, you won't see the object. That is the idea behind. And we could not get what is bhunaga decoction in this. Other things one can understand, black mica one can understand, but bhunaga nobody could translate. So this is the sorry state of affairs in one sense.